JFT, just fair and direct.
Okay, good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week April the 13th until April the 17th. I am Charalambos, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, following the RBA decision last week, this week the central bank torch will be passed to the Bank of Canada. We have a Bank of Canada meeting. As for the economic data, we get Australia's employment data for March, China's GDP for the first quarter, Sweden's CPIs for March, as well as the US New York Empire State PMI for April. Usually the last one is not a major market mover, but maybe this time it will attract some special attention. Also, for another week, investors may keep their gaze locked on the spreading of the coronavirus. Now, on Monday, today, the economic calendar is relatively empty as it is Easter Monday in most nations under our radar. Markets in Europe, Australia, and New Zealand are closed. So once again, market participants may keep their gaze locked on numbers and headlines surrounding the coronavirus outbreak. Now, on Sunday, both infected cases and deaths slowed worldwide, increasing the chances that the pandemic may have started leveling off. You can see the graph here where I have the day-by-day change in infected cases and deaths. The blue line is the death numbers, and the gray line is the infected cases numbers. And you can see that on Sunday we had a notable slowdown in both infected cases and deaths. So as I said that has increased may have increased the chances that the pandemic may have started leveling off. However, we are still reluctant to trust a long-lasting recovery in the broader market sentiment. Just a day of new records in deaths and cases may be enough to spark fresh fears and prompt investors to abandon risk-linked assets in favor of the safe havens. Even if we have already reached the peak in the outbreak, we believe that the lockdown measures could be extended for a while more if indeed governments around the globe want to contain the virus. And when we get a free movement permission, many people may still be hesitant to get out of their homes and start spending. So having all this in mind, the economic wounds could drag well into the second quarter of the year. Now, on Tuesday during the Asian morning, Australia's NAB business confidence index for March is coming out, but no forecast is currently available. In February, the index slid to -4 from -1, and we wouldn't be surprised if the index slides further into the negative territory. After all, the economic damages around the globe due to the coronavirus fast spreading have been more severe during the month of March. What's more, given how much emphasis the RBA places on employment and wage growth data, we will pay extra attention to the labor costs sub-index, the quarter-over-quarter rolling rate of which held steady at 0.9% in February. Now, later in the day, we get the US NFIB Small Business Optimism Index for March, for which there is no forecast either. But due to the pandemic fast spreading, we see the risks as tilted to the downside. Just for the record, February's print was at 104.5. Now, moving to Wednesday, the spotlight is likely to fall on the Bank of Canada interest rate decision. On March 27th, the bank decided to slash interest rates to 0.25% and to launch a QE program in order to safeguard its economy from the effects of the coronavirus spreading. The Governing Council highlighted its readiness to take further action to support the economy and the financial system, but they also noted that the policy rate is now to its effective lower bound. Last Thursday, the employment report for March disappointed, largely with the unemployment rate surging to 7.8% from 5.6%, and the net change in employment revealing that more than 1 million jobs have been lost, which is the worst print in Canada's history, at least since we can find data from. This may have increased the chances for more stimulus by the Bank of Canada, but bearing in mind that officials clearly noted that the policy rate has reached its effective lower bound, we don't expect a rate cut at this gathering. Maybe officials will decide to expand their QE program, which could prove slightly negative for the Canadian dollar. However, if the latest slowdown in the coronavirus infected cases continues for a while, for a few more days, officials may decide to hold off from acting in order to see whether this improvement will continue and whether the already adopted measures, the rate cuts and the launch of the QE, have been having the desired effects on the Canadian economy. So in case we get an expansion of the QE program, the Canadian dollar may come under some selling interest. On the other hand, if Bank of Canada officials decide to remain on hold and do not touch their already adopted measures, this could cause the Canadian dollar to experience a relief bounce. Now, as for Wednesday's data, during the Asian trading, China's trade balance for March is due to be released, and the forecast suggests that the nation's $7.09 billion deficit has turned into a surplus of $19.10 billion. However, the details are not so encouraging, as both exports and imports are still expected to have continued sliding. The trade balance will turn into a surplus just because exports may have fallen at a slower pace than in February and because imports may have slid by more. Later in the day, we have Sweden's CPIs for March. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are forecast to have declined to 0.7% year over year from 1%, but as we have noted several times, we prefer to pay more attention to the core CPIF rate, which excludes the volatile items of energy. In February, that rate held steady at 1.6% year over year. Now, on the 16th and 19th of March, the Riksbank decided to extend its bond purchases this year by up to 300 billion Swedish kronas in order to mitigate the effects of the pandemic, while on March 26th, officials decided to initiate purchases of commercial paper issued by Swedish non-financial corporations. It appears that Swedish policymakers do not want to cut rates back into negative waters. Remember that interest rates in Sweden stand at 0%. And that's why they are expanding their purchases. If the core CPIF rate stays close to its current levels, this would mean that the slide in the headline prints is mostly due to a tumble in oil prices and may encourage officials to wait for a while more before deciding whether additional measures are needed, especially if the slowdown in global infected cases continues. However, a notable slowdown in core inflation, the core CPIF rate, may prompt policymakers to act again and expand further their QE purchases. Now, from the US, we get retail sales, industrial production, both for March, and the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index for April. Both the headline and core retail sales are expected to have tumbled 7% month over month and 4% month over month after sliding 0.5% and 0.4% respectively. Those will be the biggest declines since we can find data from, but bearing in mind that investors already know that the US economy was hit hard due to the virus in March, big slides are unlikely to disappoint. The same applies to the industrial production, which is also expected to have slid notably. Market participants may now pay some extra attention to the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index, although there are signs that the pandemic may be leveling off now in April. This manufacturing index is expected to have fallen further into the negative territory to minus 35 from minus 21.5, which may be an early omen that the sector, the manufacturing sector wounds, may have dragged for more than previously anticipated. So a larger than expected tumble could raise questions as to whether the market and the ISM manufacturing prints for the US as a whole will disappoint as well. Now, on Thursday during the Asian morning, we get Australia's employment report for March. The unemployment the unemployment rate is forecast to have risen to 5.5% from 5.1%, while the net change in employment is expected to show that the economy lost 40,000 jobs after gaining 26,700 in February. Now, at their most recent gathering last week, RBA policymakers left monetary policy unchanged and offered some details with regards to their QE program. They noted that they will do what is necessary to achieve a three-year yield target of 0.25%, with the target expected to remain in place until progress is being made towards the goals of full employment and inflation. However, they added that if conditions continue to improve, it is likely that smaller and less frequent purchases of government bonds will be required. So if the situation with the coronavirus continues to improve, this means that RBA officials may scale back their QE purchases. After saying that interest rates have reached their effective lower bound at the prior meeting, the aforementioned points suggest that there is very little chance of expanding their QE programs. So they are unlikely to cut interest rates because they said that the interest rates have reached the effective lower bound. And last week, they said that they are unlikely to expand their QE program. Maybe they could scale it back if the conditions with regards to the coronavirus continues to improve. So it would be interesting to see whether a disappointing jobs report with the unemployment rate rising further above the 4.5% threshold, which the RBA expects to start generating inflationary pressures, will force them to change their minds and start considering a QE expansion. Because the RBA has a dual mandate, employment and inflation, a disappointing employment report, it remains to be seen whether a disappointing employment report will force RBA policymakers to change their mind and start considering a QE expansion. Now, later in the day, we get Germany's final inflation data for March, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. Eurozone's industrial production for February is also due to be released, and the forecast points to a 0.2% month-over-month slide after a 2.3% increase in January. From the US, we have building permits and housing starts for March, as well as the Philly Fed Manufacturing Index for April. Both building permits and housing starts are expected to have declined somewhat, while the Philly Fed Index is forecast to have slid to minus 30 from minus 12.7. Similarly, with the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index, this could be an early sign over whether the damages in the manufacturing sector would drag more than previously estimated. Now, finally, on Friday, in Asia, we get China's GDP for the first quarter, as well as retail sales industrial production and fixed asset investment, all for March. The nation's economy is all but certain to have shrunk in the first 3 months of the year due to the coronavirus outbreak, with the market consensus pointing to a 6% contraction. Retail sales, industrial production, and fixed asset investment are all expected to have continued sliding in March, but at a slower pace than in February. Now, bearing in mind that the spreading of the virus in China slowed notably during the third month of this year, we wouldn't be surprised if we get slightly better readings. The big question now is whether the economy has started recovering in the second quarter after the nation has lifted several restrictive measures. Now, as for the rest of Friday's data, the only worth mentioning is Eurozone's final CPIs for March, which, as always, are expected to confirm their initial prints. So that's it from me. Are there any questions? I will give you a few seconds if you have any questions to write them down. Okay, it appears that we don't have any questions, so that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time. So goodbye. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday.
JFT, just fair and direct.